So last time I was discussing mathematical modeling of physical systems. I talked about mechanical systems, and then I talked about electrical systems. So basically for these two types of systems, we use some basic elements, and we can model even much more complex systems using the same simple basic elements. And then I showed you some examples. I showed you modeling of a DC motor, which is a very important device for our purposes, for a lot of mechanical systems. These are everywhere. So whenever you want to control a moving system, you have to use, most of the time you use an electric motor. So in this device, there's an electric circuit. So you use an electrical modeling tools to model this part. And then there's a mechanical part. So you get a torque, so which is a moment. And this moment can be used to rotate things. Okay, so whatever you connect to a motor, you can make it move using that torque output. So if you, in case of a control actuation system, you use this moment to rotate a control surface of an aircraft. So you basically use these tools to get obtain equations for your entire system. So you use the electrical modeling tools to model the electrical circuit part, and then you use the mechanical tools to model the mechanical part, and then you put everything together to obtain a set of equations for your overall system. So today I would like to show you another example. So let me... So this is the system. So again, this is another benefit of going through the lecture through this computer display. So you don't have to write notes. So that way we save some time, and then this time will allow me to go over this example in detail. So this is also a very common setup. So you can find examples of this system everywhere in your daily life. So let me explain you what's happening here. So there's an electric motor here. Okay, so you apply some electrical voltage to this circuit, which will apply a torque through this DC motor, and that motion will be transformed into the linear motion of a mass here. Okay, so this motor drives this gear, and that gear is translated into translational motion here, and then this translational motion will make a mass move back and forth. Okay, so for example, if you know how an inkjet printer works, the mechanism inside is very much like this. So there's an ink head, and that thing moves back and forth over a paper and injecting ink every time. So what you need there is you need to have a precise control of the motion of that head. Okay? So you need to know at what instant that mass is going to be, and you provide that by using a control setup like this. And there's an electric motor, and that motor drives that ink head, and usually they use belts. So actually the physical setup is very much like this. So there you have a belt, and you rotate that belt through a gear, and by controlling the position, you can control where that mass is going to be. Okay? So that's a very good example of this problem. Also, if you think about sliding doors, for example, you know, these automatic doors, the doors open and close automatically. The setup can be modeled by using this problem. So there also you have a motor, and now you have a mass that can move, and you this problem can be used to represent that setup. Also, remember what I said before. In some of these examples, you may have an actual spring and a damper, but in some of those examples, you don't see those components, but you still use these components in your modeling to represent properties of the material. For example, if you open up an inkjet printer, you may not necessarily see a spring and a damper there, but you drive the mechanism using a belt, okay? And the belt has a certain elasticity, okay? It's not a perfectly rigid belt, so the belt can extend and contract a little bit. And to include that effect, you use a spring and a damper. Okay? You will obviously not see a a real dashpot in this printer. That means you have a piston moving through a viscous fluid. You will probably not see that, but you still need to put a damper element to model the material property of that belt. Whatever that belt is made of, it will have certain damping characteristics. And to include that, you use these elements. Okay? Okay, now the goal is to obtain the equations for this system. Okay. So before we start, let's take a look at this picture and try to think about what equations we will need. Obviously, there's an electrical part. So for this, we will use electrical modeling tools. There's a resistor and an inductor. And if you remember, for an inductor, we use the inductor is a dynamic element. There's a derivative term involved. So you will have a differential equation for this part. And it will produce a moment. Okay? And that moment will cause this thing to rotate. And then it will, since there's rotation involved here, there's a torque applied, and then rotation, and this gear has a certain inertia. So you have another differential equation for this part. And then as this thing rotates, this will be, this cart will be moving back and forth, okay? So you need to consider this element as well. It says massless here, so we will see what that means, this being massless. And then the motion here will cause some forces to be created through the spring and damper. And then these forces will cause this mass to move. And then you have another inertial element here, and this mass will be also moving. And that means you need to write another differential equation for this part. Okay, so these are the components of our system, and then we need to start writing these equations. Okay, so I have the solutions prepared for this problem, so I'm going to go over that solution, and then I will be adding some additional details into the solutions. Okay, so before we, doing that, let's think about the mechanical degree of freedom for this system. So can somebody tell me what the mechanical degree of freedom here is? Two, I hear two. Does everybody agree with that? Okay, that seems about right, right? So this mass can only move in one direction, which is expressed through this coordinate axis, y. So there's 1 degree of freedom there. And then there's another cart here. This can also move. This can move independently since there's no rigid connection between the two. You need another degree of freedom there. And then there's this gear rotating. So that could mislead some of you to think that that may be an additional degree of freedom. But the important thing is this gear cannot move independent of this other mass you see here, this other block. So there's a mechanical connection there. So since they have to move together, the only 1 degree of freedom is involved there. So anyway, so what I just explained, they are already written here, so you can read through this later. Okay, so we start writing the equations. We start with the electrical part. So I'm just writing the Kirchhoff law. So the voltage, this voltage source is V. And then I write the voltage across this loop. So there's the potential drop due to the resistor here, which is this term. And then the potential change over the inductor is given by this derivative term. And then there's the back EMF voltage for the motor, which is this term. And then you come back to the point where you started, and then the total net voltage change should be equal to zero. So this is the equation for the electrical part. So this is my first equation. So if you look at this equation here, This is a constant number, which is our assumption. This is a constant number. This is the current flowing through the circuit. V is the voltage supplied externally. So I just leave it as a simple V term. And then there's this back EMF voltage. But we know that back EMF voltage depends on how fast the motor rotates. So we use this linear expression for the back EMF voltage. And the omega is can be also written as the theta or dt term. Okay, so this is the first equation. Then we come to the second equation. The second equation is for this inertial element. So this gear has an inertia, and then we need to write the equation for this inertial element, which is basically this equation. The moment of inertia times the angular acceleration is equal to the total moment applied to that element. And for the total element, I use this free body diagram. Okay, so first I make the assumption that I use theta to represent rotation, and I take this direction to be positive. So this is my positive theta direction. The torque applied by the motor is in this direction. That is actually that was given in the question. If you read the question here, a positive voltage applied to the circuit causes the motor to drive the massless cart towards right. So when you apply a positive voltage, this thing goes to the right. That thing going to the right means that the gear should be rotating counterclockwise. So that's why I put the direction of the moment in this way. And then if you look at the picture, so this is the moment applied by the motor, and then there should be another force applied by this cart. Okay, so since they are connected through this gear setup, this can also apply force to the to that gear. So I represent that force with FL, and since this gear has a radius of R, the moment due to this force becomes FL times R, and the direction of this force doesn't really matter. I just choose it that way. So that's my assumption. So I put this FL in this direction. So when I add up these two moments, the equation for this gear becomes this second equation. I have a second order differential term, and then this is the total moment. So this is the moment applied by the motor, which is proportional to the current flowing in the circuit. So the motor torque is given by this expression. And then this TL comes from this the connection between the gear and this massless cart. So I don't know what that is yet. So I move on to this massless cart. So I draw a free body diagram for this part and then start writing the forces for that. So this is, you see that here. And to be able to write these spring and damper forces, I make this assumption. So let me show you what these are on the figure. There's Y1 and Y, and those are the coordinates you see here. Y is the position of this mass, Y1 is the position of the massless cart, and I assume that they are both positive and Y1 is greater than Y, which means this spring is in expanded, right? Okay, and similarly, I assume that the speeds are also both positive, and there's this inequality between them. Due to these assumptions, I can write these two forces, and they should be both acting towards left with these magnitudes. And then I know that there's an FL force which is applied by the gear on this massless cart. Okay, so this is the same force as this one, but in the opposite direction. So this is the action-reaction principle Newton's, you remember that, right? So the third law of motion by Newton says that for every force, there should be a reaction force in the opposite direction. So that means if this cart applies a force FL to the gear, then the gear must be applying the same force in the opposite direction to the cart. So you have this FL term. So these, there are three forces on this massless cart, and they are all shown here. And then I use the Newton's law for this block, but remember that this block was given to have no mass. So I use this law, but since mass is equal to zero, this gives me that the total force must be equal to zero, and that's because mass is equal to zero. Okay? So which gives me this equality. All the forces should sum up to zero, basically. And this gives me this expression, FL in terms of this Y and Y1 and their derivatives. And now we have this one last element, which is this mass. So as the last element, I write the free body diagram for that block. And then there are four forces, two spring forces and two damper forces. And these are the directions and the expressions for these forces. This has a mass M. So I add all the forces and equate that to mass times the second time derivative of the position for that block. Okay, so this is my third equation. Okay, now I have all the equations written down, so I need to put these together. So let me do that here. Let me go up and then copy all the equations I have written before. So this is the first equation. And then the second equation for the rotational inertial element, which was this one. So this is the last equation. Okay, so these are the three equations, right, which are hopefully correct. Okay, so once you've written down all the equations, you need to think about if these are what you need, or you have to somehow make some changes. So you need to think about how, if these equations are solvable, in other words. So this is the first equation. You apply a voltage, okay, that's fine, and then you get due to this voltage applied, there will be some current flowing that will start flowing in the circuit, which you can find through solving this. But then there's this VB term. So you need to know what VB is to be able to solve this. Okay? At this point, we know that VB is the back EMF voltage, and that voltage depends on how fast the thing rotates. So we had that expression. So we need to go up there and find the expression for that and then bring it and plug it into that equation. So VB was equal to this. So let me just copy that and then write it here. Okay, so it looks like the first equation is in a good shape. Now let's come to the second equation. So second equation is a differential equation on theta, and there's theta here, so this is the connection between these two equations. And then there's Tm term, but we know that Tm also depends on some system variables, which is the current. So Tm depends on the current in the circuit, so I should take that and then put that into that equation. Okay, now So you see a strong coupling between these two equations, right? So you have theta and current in the first equation, you have theta and current in the second equation, so those two equations need to be solved together. There's also this moment term TL. Again, to be able to solve these two equations, you need to know this TL as well. And just like the other terms, TL also depends on some system variables. So this is the expression for TL. So let me take that and put it here. FL times R ben de bu işin biraz suyunu çıkarttım gerçi de. Bu yıllarca tahta ders anlatmış birisi için büyük bir şey bunlar, mutluluk. Gerçi şey olabilir. Bu insanı yerleşim normal saatte kartları da oynatmaya çalışır bir insan büyük de. Öyle şeyler, çocuklarda şey oluyor ya. Şimdi günümüzde çocuklar şeye çok alışkınlar, böyle tabletlere falan. Böyle 2 yaşındaki çocuğa veriyorsun böyle tablette, böyle elle şey yapıyor falan. Sonra aynı çocuk gidiyor televizyonda da eline böyle şey ekranı değiştirmeye falan çalışıyor. Okay, so I need to put FL into this equation, and okay, so this is FL. So let me instead of FL, I should write this. Okay, so now I have inserted my FL term into the function. And then I have my third equation. So these are constant numbers. Everything, this is fine, this is fine. So this equation is already seem to be in a good shape. Okay? Now, I have these three equations. But do you think these three equations are now solvable? Well, not really, and let me tell you why. I have this equation, I have the current and theta as variable in that equation. In the second equation, I have theta, current, and then I have these two coordinates, y1 and y. And in the last equation, I have y1, y, and then their time derivatives. So there are too many variables here to be solved by these equations. But in fact, not all these coordinates are independent. So I have theta here, and then I have y1 appearing in this equation. So let me go back to the figure and look at what those are for. y1 shows the position of this massless cart, and theta is the position of the gear. Okay? And they are connected, so there's a constraint that relates these two coordinates to each other. And I have to include that constraint in my equations. And if you look at this diagram here, you can easily see that that constraint I'm looking for is the following. So there's this relation between the y1 and theta coordinates. Okay, so this relation has to be satisfied. Otherwise, if you don't include this relation, that means the theta can rotate independent of y1, which means the gear should be slipping. And you will not be able to solve this equation without including this constraint into your equations. Okay, so this is the last thing I need to do. So I need to replace y1 terms with theta and r. So at the last step, I go back to this equation set and I do the following. I remove all these y1 terms and replace them with these theta r terms. And for y1 dot, Since R is a constant number, Y1 dot is equal to theta dot R. And similarly, you need to do the same here. Aslında bu noktada şey yapabilirmişim. Bunu önceden hazırlayıp yapılmış var diye koyabilirmişim. Neyse, ikinci seksiyonu öyle yaparım artık. Okay. Okay, so this is the this is a mathematical model for this system. And if you inspect every term one by one, you will see that there is only one external input. There is one parameter that will make the entire system move, and that is this voltage. Okay, so without applying any voltage here, everything will remain as they are. There will be no change in these parameters. But once you apply a voltage here, the entire system will go into action. So this voltage will cause a current, and that current will cause a moment. That moment will cause a rotation here, and that rotation will cause this mass to move finally. Okay, so this is the input, external input to the system. And if you know what that is, you can solve these differential equations, and then that will allow you to analyze the system. So you can answer questions like, what happens if I apply 5 volts to this system? Or if I apply a voltage in the form of a sinusoidal wave, how will that affect the motion of the mass? So all these things will be done after that. Okay? Do you have any questions? Okay. So all these equations are fine. So you find these equations in books, and you see these examples, and you write these equations yourself, and then you get all these mathematical functions, mathematical equations. But for me, at least, these don't really mean a lot. So they're just a bunch of equations, okay? So it's hard for me to believe these really present an actual system, a real-world system. So what makes you appreciate is to see these in action. And for that, you need to go into the lab and to have a setup like this and calculate all these things, solve all these equations, and then create plots like, so if I apply a sine wave to the voltage, then the mass should be moving like that. Okay, so this is the Y, the solution of mass. So you calculate this in computer, in MATLAB, for example. You plot that and you see all these plots. And what makes you appreciate all this effort is when you see this matches real world. And to be able to do that, you, as I said before, you go into the lab, you take a voltage source, you connect all the wires, you turn the switch on, you apply the voltage, and you see that thing moving. And you record that, you measure that motion, and then create a plot and bring it. And when you see that plot sits right on top of what you expected to see, then at that point, the satisfaction you get is priceless. So you will have some lab sessions today. Not today, I'm sorry, this semester. I'm not sure if you'll be that lucky to see that kind of a match, but hopefully those lab sessions will be very rewarding. Dediğim gibi yani bu biraz da ben kişisel bir şey de oluyor değil mi? Bütün kitapları okuyorsunuz, denklemleri çalışıyorsunuz falan. Onlar hep böyle hani birisi bir şeyler uydurmuş ama yani ne belli öyle olacak falan gibi hissediyorsun ama onun gerçek hayata uygulandığını görmek çok şey katıyor insana. Yani onu uygulamak. Dolayısıyla bu laboratuvarları bu sene en azından 2 tane lab session'ınız olacak. Yani çok büyük beklentiye sokmak istemiyorum sizi. Hayal kırıklığına uğrayabilirsiniz laboratuvarda. Ama gerçekten çok eğlenceli olacağını düşünüyorum. Ve hep şey de söylüyorum, yani ben 172 dersinde söylemiştim. O deneyleri isteyenler gidip kullanabilirler de. Yani bu ders içerisinde belki ne bileyim 5 kişi gideceksiniz. İşte 20 dakikada bir şeyler gösterecek asistan size. Belki o kadar şey olmayacak ama ya ben bu işi çok sevdim. Gelip bununla biraz oynamak istiyorum diyenler de mutlaka laboratuvara sokmak istiyorum. Çünkü orada çok değerli ekipmanlar var ve boş bekliyorlar neticede. Onların kullanılması lazım. O yüzden bunları şey zamanı gelince tekrar konuşuruz. Okay, so hopefully you will have some lab sessions and then you will see how our calculations are really representative of the real world, and hopefully you will be satisfied that there's a close match. But you don't have to be limited to those lab sessions. If you are just like me, I mean, if we had these things when I was a student, I would die to play with these things. So if you are like that, so you are hopefully welcome to the lab whenever you want, and you are welcome to play with these things and then experiment all these things and try different ideas. Okay, so we are in a good time to give a break. So let's give a short break, and after that I will start showing you how to use these equations to analyze the system. Okay?